Hi, everyone.
So, website at the speed of light. So, I am Luis. I am a web developer since, a long time ago, since effectively, like, the 90s. I am not exactly an English speaker. Well, I am an English speaker. I just don't like English. English is hard. It's harder than PHP. With that in mind, beer. Well, I'm not also a front-end developer. I'm more a back-end developer or a mobile developer, but not exactly a front-end developer. So if you expect front-end snazzy, shiny stuff, no. So, website left speed of light. No worries. Speed of light is an interesting concept. It changes depending on the environment. Most of it is around around 300,000 kilometers per second in perfect vacuum. If it's not in perfect vacuum, like in fiber optics, it depends of a lot of stuff. But roughly is that speed. And that poses a problem for us, because we want our websites to be as fast as possible, but the communication channel that we use for our websites, which is fiber optics between our browsers and the servers, has a limit. And the limit is the network latency, the dreadful latency. It is roughly between UK and New Zealand, which is on the other side of the world, around the maximum speed is around 60,000 kilometers per second, which is roughly like a fifth of the speed of light, which is not good enough. So the answer, website has speed of light? The answer is no. It's physically impossible to get that. So, yeah, goodbye. Talk then. It's not possible to get the speed of light on a website, because the servers need time to process stuff, the packets need to go to the user through the internet is as slow. If you are in the UK, it's horribly slow sometimes, depending on where you are located. Even if you are in the middle of London, it's not guaranteed to be a good speed, because if you go for things like Island of Dogs, you will get ADSL, not fiber, for instance. And the ADSL there will be very slow, like 10 megabits at the most, with luck. And that's due to infrastructure. There is no fiber there. And there is no space to build fiber there. So here comes 5G one day. So what more can we do regarding the websites? We can optimize for speed on several levels. We can improve the infrastructure. We can improve the network. And that's all we will be talking about. We can do all of these things, but all of that stuff has costs, okay? Everything has a cost. So if you optimize, for instance, your code base, it has a cost, because it takes more developer hours to improve the site. You need to get better code. That has a cost. The cost may not be perceptible, but it incurs if you have a faster site that has a bigger code base because it's more efficient, but it needs to decouple stuff to be that efficient, it will have more complexity and it will incur in costs in maintenance. So you can improve the website, but has these hidden costs that you will pay along the way. So it's not exactly straightforward to think, oh, we get the fastest site that we can. Yeah, you can throw money to it, but that's money that you are going to throw. Either way, you can improve for time it takes to execute, time it takes to develop the site by itself. You can throw more money on it, or you can add more resources, like more developers, to get things done. All of these has a cost. So as a business, and the business owner, when you are facing the business owners, as either our clients or employees, or yourselves, you have to think about this, because websites at the speed of light cost horribly amount of money, because you have to throw to them a huge amount of resources, like huge amount of servers, huge amount of memory, CPUs, and you have to have a very big team behind them to keep them working. So, on the network, what can we do? When you have a web server that works with the internet, you have to connect it to the internet. You need to get a connection, and then the browser will connect through the internet to your server, eventually, with luck. To that, you need location. Your data center is the most fundamental thing that will make the difference between the speed of your server to your clients. So try to locate the server as near as possible to the majority of your clients. Like if your clients are all in the UK, please place your server in the UK. Because if it needs to go all the way to the United States, yes, the servers are cheaper in the United States. But, well, a bit cheaper in the United States. But you will pay the penalty with the increased latency. So your server will respond slightly slower. After locating the servers, you can decide, well, I can throw more money into the problem and get more users and be like Netflix with data centers everywhere. And for that, you decide that you need your users to go to the server that is nearest to them. So you need to configure the DNS accordingly. There are some DNS services like Amazon Route 53 that allow you to set up regional geolocation DNS resolution, meaning that if you have a server, for instance, in the United States and another in the UK, you can decide that users from UK are served from that data center and users from the United States are from that data center. And you can also define rules that say that it goes to the server that is responding with the least latency, meaning you don't impose a geolocation restriction, you just care about the latency of the servers, which is even better because if you create suddenly a server, for instance, in Germany, it depends on how the connections between your user and the nearest server works. So DNS optimization is a huge plus because it will make the server that is nearest to your user to be the one responding to the requests. And the other location thing that you can work with is by using CDN. You can use Akamai, CloudFront, or any other CDN providers. They normally have a distributed network all over the world. You can define where the content is distributed to, normally, and it has, obviously, cost impact. Like, if you decide that content goes everywhere in the world, it has a cost because it gets distributed to all of their data centers. You can define that, oh, I just want it distributed to the European data centers, and it goes only for the server that they have in Europe. CDN also makes free resources from your servers, because before, if you don't implement CDNs, what happens is you have, for instance, 20 resources on your server, and your server needs to dispatch them to your user. If you use a CDN, suddenly you only need to distribute like 3 of them. The other 17 go from the CDN, which is someone else's problem kind of thing. Well, it will be the problem of your user, naturally, because he needs to receive the same 20 resources anyway. But your server is only responsible for those 3 that he needs to serve, which means it has the other slots or time slots free to serve another request. So, on the server stack, what can we do? Well, there is not much we can do. Well, there is actually a lot that we can do, but it depends a lot of what you want to do and what kind of site you are serving. The best recommendation is use the best for the task at hand. If it's flat files like JPEGs and not processed or PHP files, probably you will get better results by having like an Nginx in front of your site and just serve directly the files with the Nginx or something like that. If it's PHP, it depends on how you set it up. Either Nginx as a subprocess or Apache module, or you need to pick and test, because the velocities of serving different files vary a lot with the even with the versions of these softwares. There was a gap in performance, a huge gap between Apache and Nginx. That is not that true anymore. The Apache catch up a lot in terms of speed. So the speed improvements of Apache made it's not as efficient as Nginx due to the different ways they are built, but it's pretty similar nowadays. Keep them updated, because security updates are not something to sneer about. The GDPR makes some constraints nowadays that you basically have to use the industry best practices when you handle servers and things like that. So one of the industry best practices, keep your infrastructure updated. So apply the security updates, apply the best stable versions that is possible. If not, upgrade your code, because you then need to upgrade your code before you upgrade, for instance, PHP. If you are still on PHP 5.6, you may need to roll out a migration path. I hope you are on 5.6 at least. You are? Anyone using PHP less than 5.6?
Not me.
It's inevitable. There are constraints that escape developers and even business. Basically, the business is generating money and can't change things that easy. So it's understandable. It's not ideal, but understandable. Keep them secure. Keep them secure is a funny thing. For instance, if you use MongoDB, if you are not careful with the rules, security rules, you may be exposing MongoDB directly to the public. You don't have that problem in AWS because on AWS everything is closed by default when you create a new server. You have to explicitly open the port, but on other providers that is not that so, and the responsibility of closing things is inside the virtual machine. So if you use software, try to to reduce the exposure security-wise, lock everything down, and unless you really need the ports open, like port 80 or the SSL, the 443. So yeah, keep them secure, keep them locked. Security. Take security seriously. Monitor is another big thing. You need to be GDPR in the other day, a bit ago, was talking about keeping data secure and so on. One of the parts was the you need to inform the overseer, the ICU, if there is a breach and things like that. But how do you discover if there is a breach if you don't monitor anything? Or if you don't read the log files? So yeah, you need to monitor everything, you need to create alerts, you need to have all of that stuff. So if you see, for instance, a sudden drop in connections on your servers, something may be wrong. Either your server is down, or someone is using the whole bandwidth, or you are suffering a denial of service. If you don't have a monitoring system, you will not notice what's going on. And you can't make measures like placing Fastly to filter out the attack, for instance. And please don't do code like this. What's the problem with this code? Among other things. Like no hashing, no SQL injection, using posts directly. Yeah. So no, don't use things like this, please. It's not good enough. You can do better, I hope. I hope everyone is able to do better. So, measure everything, monitor everything. If you want to improve a website for speed, you need to monitor everything. You need to have statistics of the server, because you can't improve something that you have no measure of what you are talking about. So you want to improve the whole request load, so you need to have statistics of that. Just use A-B testing, A-B Apache benchmark, or some other tool that I don't remember now, but Siege or something like that. Just use tools that are designed to do this kind of measures to see what you can get from your servers. And then, when you improve your code and you improve your website, you know that you are making an improvement, not making things worse. Because imagine that, you do an improvement on 10 requests and you If you get 20 requests, you get some sort of a race condition with memory problems, and suddenly the speed is 1/2 of what it was before, the improvement. So you need to have some sort of an improvement to get the statistics to figure out if you are actually improving things or not. And when you monitor stuff and get statistics, be wary of what you place on the logs. I have seen from code bases on production that are logging everything in the kitchen sink, like the whole objects in the log. Try not to do that. Try to filter out the information, because you may be storing in the logs personal data, and again, GDPR will nail you because of that. It's not fun. So you get GDPR bound data, private data of users in some log system somewhere in the cloud that we are not supposed to do. So, yes, software development is getting more complicated. Now, speed things, you can actually do some interesting stuff with HTTP, just HTTP. There is a huge difference between HTTP 1.1, which is mostly the current version, or HTTP 2, which is also more or less current, but is more modern, and it has some requirements to set up. The differences are, in terms of connections, HTTP 1.1 handles everything as a different connection. So you have, even if the connections can be somewhat reused with the persistent, it's not a given that they are be reused. Sometimes they will generate a new connection, and that has a cost. There is a limit of the number of connections that the browsers will create for you. Roughly between, depending on the browser, between 4 and 6. But it will vary depending on operating system, browser, and so on. But it's not a huge quantity. And this is per domain in HTTP 1.1. So if you, one of the tricks that you do to speed up your website is, oh, we create a CDN, several subdomains from your main domain, and place them all to be served the assets, like the image, be served one on each different subdomain. That works if your server is not serving all of them, because then you can be creating a bottleneck on your server, because your server also has a number of connection limit. In terms of headers, the headers in HTTP 1.1 are sent on every request in clear text, which is a huge waste of space and bandwidth. In HTTP 2, they are sent compressed, and they are stored in some sort of a dictionary that is agreed between the server and the browser, meaning that a specific header is sent only once. After that, is only sent the number of it. So it's not repeated constantly. Resources. And this comes, these two things, the resources, which is basically the body of every request, are handled by HTTP 1.1 and 2 completely differently. On HTTP 1.1, every connection is a resource, and you just receive it. And then you may get a new request with a new resource, and you just receive it. On HTTP 2, as it uses just one connection, hopefully, what happens is that connection is used to send all the requests. So what happens is if you have 20 assets that you want from your server, you get 20 requests from that one connection. And the browser and the server will negotiate how to send the requests using prioritization. You can say things like, I want this resource first, and I don't care about that resource. So that resource will come at the as last. That's a new thing on HTTP2, which is pretty powerful. And then the last optimization is something about the brain, the human brain. Basically, you see things and you interpret things on a specific speed. Your brain has a delay. And the way you animate things on the screen will make an influence on how you perceive the speed of things. One of the things that you can do is take care to get your assets that are on the top of the page, which is what is rendered first, with a bigger priority. So they reach the browser first, and the browser is able to render the page to the user immediately. On HTTP2, you can tweak the priorities of the resources and get be assured that they are sent first. The other thing that you can do, and it's valid for both HTTP2 and HTTP 1.1, is move all the JavaScript to the bottom of the page, because JavaScript at the top of the page will block the rendering. The same with fonts. If you don't need fonts, remove them, because they will slow down everything. The browser will only render the page after the font is loaded. Even with the fonts from Google Fonts, which is a CDN, and probably the font is on the browser, they will do a handshake to the Google servers, at least a handshake to check if the font is the same. And that will slow the render of the page until that handshake is done. So you need to work a bit on that to reach the best performance of your server. So what can we do? What can I show you? Some examples of how things can be done. So, who has used cache systems? Varnish, for instance, obviously. It's the first thing. If you need more speed, you use something like Varnish in front of your server. Who is warming up Varnish? Some answer. It's not easy to do, but it's doable. Basically, warming up is you know what are the resources that people are going to look for, so you ensure that those resources are on the cache system already, even before the first request. The problem is if they are not there, they will be horribly slow. The cache system will be horribly slow. For the first user, at least. And yes, varnish and any cache system is very nice, but there's one little problem, which is cache invalidation. So when you delete a resource from your site, ensuring that that resource is also deleted from the cache system. So that increases the complexity of managing your site. And managing a cache system is pretty hard. Demo time. Who likes a demo? Let's see how this works. Demo time. Oh, it should be fine. Where is my mouse? Yeah, so this is basically a very naive implementation of a cache system. So, what do we have here? We grab two arguments here. One to check if the system is to be warmed up, the cache is to be warmed up or not. And the other one is our normal request to check, get a value. And then we get a value by opening this data file, which is pretty slow. And I made sure that it's horribly slow by using a US sleep. So it's even slower. And basically that's it. And then we get a get value cached, which basically uses an array to cache the values. A simple example of the different behavior of a cache. And then we fetch the value twice to demonstrate different warmed up or not warmed up fetch of the value. So basically, if I do, no, this was another thing. PHP, there, demo one, then zero, let's fetch the 100 value. It's not showing up. Huh? Ah, wrong folder. Ah, correct folder now. Okay. If we are not using any cache, we just get the requested value each time. We took this time to process. 59 points something, whatever this means, like 1 second or something. If we don't use the cache, if we use the cache but don't warm up the cache, on the first request it takes more or less the same time, on the second request it's almost instant. On the third option, which is warming up the cache before we do any request, as expected, is almost instant on both requests. So this is basically how a normal request goes, a cached request goes with a normal cache without any warming up, and now a cache with a warming up works. You can apply this technique to anything in your code base. For instance, if you have things like file access is particularly slow. So basically you will need to just use some sort of memory have a session, a memory session, to store that value while after you use it the first time, or warming it up even before you do the request. Bear in mind that file system is pretty slow, and you can, one of the first things that you can do on your website is moving the session from file based, as is the default on PHP, to memcached, which is pretty simple to do. And that is the second demo, actually. Second demo, which is already running. Yeah. So, no, not that. Where is the browser? So basically this code, what this code is doing in this case is just this. Session start, if the session value doesn't exist, initialize it with zero, increment it, and output it. Pretty easy. And if I go to this address, /info, and I go to the session, I'm using the session memcached on the localhost. This is very simple to set up. The only thing that you need to do to set up memcached to use the memcached server, apart from installing it and running it naturally, is to have these two tokens on your PHP ini. This is built in on PHP and it's ready to deploy after you install memcached. There are some concerns. Mostly you need to have memory on your server because this is going to use memory. There are some advantages. You can have multiple memcache. You can have multiple memcache like this, obviously separated by a comma. So imagine this is a IP address. So you can have multiple addresses. What this does is when you store a value on memcache or on the session, it will get replicated on every server that is defined on memcache list. This is very useful if you decide to set up several different PHP servers to run your web server and place, for instance, an Elastic Load Balancer, and you don't want to keep the session on the Elastic Load Balancer, because you can, when you create a load balancer, normally you can create a persistent connection on the load balancer, which means that the browser goes to the load balancer and goes to the first server that is available on the first time, and on the second time it keeps going to the same server. That's called the persistent load balancer. You can define the load balancer not to do that and just go to the most free available server, and then in that case you will need something like this, because the session will not be kept for you, because you have no warranty of what is this web server that you are going to hit. it may be a different server, and the local session that PHP holds will be different. It may be empty, for instance. And so you will need some strategy like this, or store the session on the database or something like that. But you will need a central place of truth for your session. And obviously, if you use something like this, try not to store objects or anything very big in the session. Like, don't store in the session anything that you can't recreate. Store just the ID of the user, not the user object, for instance. So to minimize the size of the session, because God knows what happens if the session memory is exhausted. Probably some random pieces of information just disappear. But most probably you will crash some users and they will not be happy. And that's it. So that's websites at speed of light.
Thank you, Louis. Do we have any questions? We've got a few minutes.
I was wondering what your opinion is on the Memcached versus Redis in terms of speed.
I have absolutely no opinion. Use whatever. Did you test it both? The only reason I placed the example with Memcache was because it's built in PHP and it's easy to set up on Mac. I didn't test it on with Redis, but it's fine.
We're actually using Redis for our session.
I believe Redis has some advantages over Memcache regarding. There are some options to store the Redis data in disk, if you want.
Yeah.
Which Memcache, I don't believe, has that kind of capability, because it's memory only, and it's designed to be that, I believe. But yes, use whatever you are more comfortable. The speed difference probably is not that significant in the end of the day, because most of these the difference in terms of functionality are very minimal in terms of the speed that you get in reality, because you don't have that. Probably the access to Redis or Memcache is not that spiky and continuous burst. So the speed difference between them, as you said, they are not that significant nowadays. So just use whatever is more comfortable for you, because you have to maintain them. So if you are used to Redis, use Redis. One of the problems I have with storing things in Memcached is if the server crashes, it's dead. The info disappears. So for sessions is fine if the session of the user can be reconstructed from the database, meaning like things like shopping cart persistency and things like that are on the database also. So use whatever it's best for you. They both work, that's for sure. File-based persistence on Redis will slow down Redis a bit, significantly, comparatively with just memory, based. In that case, I will recommend you to do some metrics to check the speed, because they will be different, especially when you need to restart the Redis. The advantage is it will recover and will reload the data. That's the advantage of file backup of the Redis. You gain that, but you lose speed, basically. It's always a trade-off.
Time for another question?
We noticed when we moved to PHP 7 that we perceived a significant speed improvement, but also a big drop in the memory footprint on the server. There's talk of PHP 7.2 having another big bump.
Yes, there is. I think on PHP 2 and PHP even PHP 3, there are some new optimizations that come in play. And they will improve. It's not as dramatic as it was before. Forget about the difference between 5.6 and 7 is absurd. It's like 30% or something. It's huge. The difference between 7.1 and 7.2 and 7.3 are going to be minimal. One of the things that is under construction in PHP, I think, is the just-in-time compiler. But I'm not sure when it will land. That will give a good boost of speed. But there is no foreseen PHP 7.4, 0.5. God knows.
Stefan Lerdorf, Rasmus Lerdorf, did the keynote at Manchester, and he was showing some metrics of the increases in speeds, and if they're true, it's certainly worth staying with the latest version if speed is a real issue for you.
One of the things I notice from just reading the spec of HTTP2 is the fact that it is only one connection per client will increase tremendously the quantity of users that your server is able to serve. Because before you had like 6 connections for one user. So if one user is just using one connection, suddenly the server has the ability to open 6 more users. So instance of one. So that will increase the capability of your web servers just by itself. But you lose the Gizzy compression because HTTP2 is forced to be SSL, and with SSL you can't use Gizzy compression anymore because of a security issue. So you will lose Gizzy compression.
Time for one more? I've got just one. There was some security issues over possible data leakage from using memcached. Did you come across that?
I never came across that.
See, one or two proofs of concepts where it's possible to leak data from one cache to another.
Ah.
Not trying to scare anyone. That's my area.
Well.
Sorry? Yeah, you've got all the different caches in memory alongside each other. Yeah. So, yeah, I'm just worried that
you can hack from one to the other and leak a bit of data. That's always possible. That's why it's one of the recommendations for the session is just use IDs, because if the user is allowed to use that ID, because, but like you said, you may want to use also a fingerprint of sorts to ensure that that session belongs to that user and not allow that kind of leakage. So maybe worth thinking about it.
Okay. keeps the encrypt stuff going into the cache.
Yeah, just encrypt the stuff.
If you use Elastic Cache, you can encrypt the rest with Redis on that memory.
So that memory.
Yeah. Just place everything in the cloud.
Depends on your level of paranoia, I guess. Anyway, thank you very much, Louis.